Good morning, everyone. I'm going to go ahead and get us started here. I'm Kelly Bourne, Executive Director of the Cyber Policy Center here at Stanford University. And I'm joined this morning by colleagues from almost all of our half dozen other programs. For those of you who don't know the Cyber Policy Center, our research and teaching focuses on questions around the governance of digital technology and its implications for geopolitics, security, and democracy. And our work is really intended to inform the policy agendas of governments, tech companies, civil society, and academics globally. So today's discussion, we're going to focus on the executive order that was issued by the White House last Thursday on platforms and online speech. And as a quick recap for those who might not be familiar with all of the fireworks from last week, this order threatens to repeal parts of the Community Decency Act 230, Section 230, which shields social media companies from liability for content that's been posted on their sites. It also encourages the Federal Trade Commission to take action against companies that engage in quote-unquote deceptive acts of communication, and amongst other things, would form a working group of state attorney generals to review relevant state laws. And so my colleague Daphne will go into more detail on what the act entails. It came in response to what the White House called selective censoring, and specifically in response to some actions that Twitter took against tweets that Trump had posted earlier in the week. Those tweets, for those who may not have seen them, specifically say there is no way, zero, that mail-in ballots will be anything less than substantially fraudulent. Mailboxes will be robbed, ballots will be forged, and even illegally printed out and fraudulently signed. The governor of California is sending ballots to millions of people, anyone living in the state. It goes on to say that this will be a rigged election, no way. And in response, Twitter placed a fact-checking tag leading readers to a page that indicated how unsubstantiated these claims were. This was not a new policy by Twitter, but rather enforcement of a policy that's been on the books for some time. And so today we want to discuss the details of the order, whether the White House actually has the authority to do much of what it has suggested here, and to really go through many of the concerns that this order raises. So I am joined by a number of my colleagues, and we're going to hear about 20 minutes of responses from each of them, and then try and save 30 minutes for Q&A. So would love for people to add questions in the comment box, and I will do my best to moderate them. And we're going to start with Daphne Keller, who is the director of the Program on Platform Regulation here at the Cyber Policy Center and is a former associate general counsel for Google. And Daphne, would love to hear from you what exactly the order says, how much of it the White House actually has the authority to do, and what other concerns this raises for you. We'll turn from there to Nate Persily. He's the faculty co-director of the Cyber Policy Center and directs the program on democracy and the internet here at the center, and has done a tremendous amount of work around how we can run the November elections and mail-in ballots in particular. So would love, Nate, to hear from you. What do we know about the evidence behind the tweets that started this all? What do you think about the DOJ investigation that's been promoted? And really, what do you think about the White House's proposed restraints on fact-checking and how that squares with First Amendment protections overall? There's certainly some irony here. From there, Maricha Shake, I want to turn to you. Maricha is the policy director for the Cyber Policy Center and a former member of EU Parliament and is joining us from Europe now. Would love to get a sense from you of how this order fits into the sort of broader global context of content moderation and how you think this might impact legislative proposals already on the books in the EU. Then from there, we'll go to Eileen Donahoe, director of the Global Digital Policy Incubator and former US ambassador to the UN Human Rights Council, to hear about the human rights implications of the order. And then finally, Alex Stamos, want to turn to you. Alex is director of the Cyber Policy Center's Internet Observatory and the former chief security officer at Facebook, and would love to hear how the executive order, if actually enacted, would impact the behavior of social media companies and the experience of users. So we've got a lot to cover, and I will go ahead. And with that, Daphne, turn to you. Thanks so much for making it this morning.
Thanks a lot, Kelly. I guess I want to start with just a little bit of humility about what it is that we're doing here in a week of massive public questions about systemic racism, about institutional constraints to protect citizens' rights against things like state violence. We are all experts in one corner of that picture, which is the constraints on the government as it relates to speech and online speech, and particularly what the government can do to control what platforms do with online speech. But I want to acknowledge that's a small part of a big picture. Focusing in on the order itself, and I have an annotated copy of the order that I shared over Twitter with a lot of more detailed thoughts for people who want to get super wonky about this. The order is overwhelmingly about atmospherics. It spends most of its length invoking really powerful tropes about free expression, but not in ways that necessarily have real legal impact. And I think, and a lot of experts think, what's going on here is effectively using the bully pulpit of the White House and this order to make a lot of noise as a way of coercing platforms to sort of toe the party line and adopt content policies that are the ones that the White House wants to see. And that's troubling, right? Because that is a government actor trying to shape speech rules using something other than democratically accountable legislative channels. The rhetoric, though, there's a reason that the rhetoric in the executive order is so compelling. It raises issues we are all concerned about. It talks about the fear that platforms are acting as gatekeepers, controlling what we all can say and controlling political discourse in the public sphere. Everybody's worried about that. That's not a conservative issue. You know, globally and in the US, there are people across the spectrum, political spectrum, who believe they've been the victims of biased content takedown. So this is a real issue. But the way it's raised in the executive order is not very, I would say, effective or helpful. The other sort of trope raised in it is another thing that has been embraced across the political spectrum of experts, which is the idea that platforms can have rules, but they can have their own speech rules in terms of service, but they have to be clear about those rules. The rules have to be fair with appeals and maybe a public body to oversee how that happens. And the executive order raises the idea, although it certainly doesn't mandate and couldn't mandate, that the FTC might serve in that capacity. Now, the problem with that, of course, is you're creating a government body to decide what is fair, and that's a massively complex proposition. All right, on to the nuts and bolts. There are two things in the EO that sound consequential, but are really just recommendations with no immediate consequence. One of those is suggesting that the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, should endorse a legal interpretation of CDA 230, this very important platform speech and immunity law, that is novel, that's really unsupported by the courts, and that, by the way, even if the FCC endorsed it, that wouldn't give it legal authority either. That's an interpretation saying that before platforms can claim the most important immunity in 230, which is the one that says they're not liable for user speech, before they can claim that, they have to establish that they are acting in quote-unquote good faith. That good faith standard is something that exists somewhere else in the statute, and the executive order is trying to import it as a condition for the key immunity in Section 230. But they're just saying FCC should endorse that reasoning, and FCC doesn't have to do anything and may have political reasons to not do anything here. The other thing that sounds very consequential but is just a recommendation is that the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, shall consider prohibiting misrepresentations of platforms' policies in their terms of service, and shall consider saying that it is unfair and deceptive under the Federal Trade Act. So basically, it's a consumer protection problem if platforms are not more clear about their terms of service and more fair in enforcing them. That, again, is a recommendation, and for the FTC to take it up would be a massive, resource-intensive, complicated move, but it's an interesting recommendation. Then there's some things in the EO that sound like not such a big deal, but I think maybe really are. One is saying that this interpretation of 230 that imports a good faith requirement into the key immunity shall be adopted by any federal agencies that are interacting with 230. And I think none of us quite know what that means, because it's relatively rare. That this matters for federal agencies, but it might matter for DOJ considering civil cases, for example. So watch this space. A second is that the DOJ, so Attorney General Barr, is supposed to convene state attorneys general to look at a very long list of complaints, including the possible bias of fact checkers, et cetera. I think there are a lot of state AGs who have a political interest in pursuing these questions, and so that one could prove consequential. And then the final one that I'm particularly worried about is that the DOJ, so again, Attorney General Barr, is supposed to review whether platforms are, quote, problematic vehicles for government speech due to viewpoint discrimination, unquote, and then use that as a basis for excluding them from carrying federally funded ads. So this is a DOJ-created blacklist, essentially, of platforms with policies that don't comply with, that are problematic in the view of DOJ. So that is the one I'm most concerned about. And then finally, the second draft, not the first one, says that the DOJ is supposed to propose draft legislation to amend 230 to bring it in line with this interpretation. That part is like legitimately how governance is supposed to happen. So in a way, it's good news. It moves it to the legislative realm. On the other hand, the substantive proposal that it is putting forth, I think, is very, very problematic. So that's a lot, and I'm happy to dive deeper on any of that later, but I will stop there for now.
Thanks, Daphne. Really helpful. And Nate, can we now turn to you? And for those who have questions, please go ahead and enter them in the chat box as we go.
Great, thank you. Let me reiterate what Daphne said. You know, when we planned this webinar, this seemed like the topic du jour. And needless to say, we're living in sort of bizarre times in that the news changes so rapidly. And so obviously this is not the the issue that's forefront on everyone's mind. In order to bridge a little bit the territory between this executive order and what's happening in the streets in the US, I'll just add one thing to what Kelly said originally, which is that not only are those the tweets that had the fact checks, ones that led to this EO, but also we had Twitter marking one of the president's tweets as violating its terms on glorification of violence, but keeping it up there because it was, Twitter said it was in the public interest. And so what's happening on social media, what's happening in the platforms is not disconnected from what we're seeing out in the real world. I just want to spend my 2 minutes emphasizing something that Daphne brought up, which is that it is easy to say that you know, when the president speaks, that people need to take it with a grain of salt because there's so much activity on his Twitter feed and the like. But you know, an executive order is not a tweet, and there are, you know, when you sort of take the force of law and join it with these kinds of admonitions, that there are consequences. And so even if most of what is in this EO is hortatory and is sort of describing an ambition that might not be fulfilled, it's still the case that when you have the Department of Justice undergoing an investigation of all of the platforms for political bias, there are consequences to that. Among other things, you know, the rumbling you heard through Silicon Valley last Wednesday and Thursday when this was happening was, you know, the rumbling of a lot of lawyers now waking up to realize they've got to advise their clients on how to deal with this. And if you were a platform that was on the fence as to whether you thought that maybe the platform should take down or otherwise mark something in the president's Twitter feed or other social media feed or other conservatives who were voicing similar concerns about mail balloting or the like, this is a shot across the bow, right? And it is especially true in the context of the election, so that this is the first silo, and what we'll see is you know, repeated moves between now and the election to work the refs, to try to make sure that the social media companies don't you know, disproportionately affect one or the other campaign. We saw this actually before the 2016 campaign when Facebook took down its trending news feature, which was alleged to be discriminating against conservatives. And so I think that this is the first step in a pretty, you know, long fight that we're going to see on against the social media companies over the summer. I'll just say one last thing on the substance of mail balloting, as Kelly mentioned, since I've been doing a lot of work with that. Obviously, that the fact check was correct in that there's no evidence that mail ballot states have greater amount of fraud than non-mail ballot states and the like. I should emphasize that as you go farther down to the local level, there isn't as much partisan polarization on this issue as you're seeing at the national level. So that it's local election officials, Republicans and Democrats are promoting mail ballot. I'll end there. We have a lot more to talk about, but I want to let my colleagues have some chance to talk about this.
Great. Thanks so much, Nate. And Maricha, can we turn to you for a European perspective?
Yes, thank you so much. Just adding to what my colleagues had to say, I wanted to share a few observations from the European point of view and its equivalent of Section 230, as well as the controversy between Twitter and Trump and what it might mean. And you may actually hear a helicopter going over because a couple of blocks down, as we speak, there's a Black Lives Matters demonstration in support here in Amsterdam. So it's actually going around the world, what concerns many, many Americans. And my heart goes out to my second home country. Now, going to the topic of the webinar today, especially among President Trump's opponents, it's easy and also popular to dismiss his executive order because it was hastily issued and probably out of personal vindictiveness, which I think it was. But dismissing the executive order will not make the discussion on the responsibility of tech platforms like Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Google, but also Amazon go away. And I would say especially not in Europe. I think here we see politically that there is broad consensus that regulations are needed to ensure that technology platforms respect laws like antitrust, non-discrimination, as well as freedom of expression laws, or that laws are updated to meet the realities of a digitized society. And just to remind everybody, we don't have the First Amendment, even though speech protections are very similar between the United States and Europe. But there are a number of exemptions that make questions of what is illegal or harmful speech slightly different than in the United States. But overall, tech companies benefit from protections in Europe in very, very similar ways that they do in the US under Section 230. The EU knows a safe harbor principle under the year 2000 e-commerce directive that prevents platforms from being liable for third-party content. And additionally, it is not allowed to impose a general obligation to monitor users' content online, because that would violate their rights to privacy and their rights to freedom of expression. And so most efforts to push platforms to do more against harmful content should be considered self-regulation, albeit under pressure to remove or demote harmful content, whether it is in categories of terrorism, fake news, or copyright-protected materials. Now, I've always been critical of this outsourcing of enforcement and responsibility back onto the already very powerful platforms. And I don't think we know enough about the details of commercially driven ranking and promotion or demotion of content, because a lot of the decisions that companies make every day are not very transparent or accountable, whereas what Twitter does with labeling is actually quite transparent. Now, with these steps of self-regulation, neutrality, as some platforms claim, is not a very credible one anymore. So many decisions about content are already made that I think, especially in Europe, Mark Zuckerberg will not convince otherwise, especially because of what I mentioned, the commercial ranking, promotion, targeting of ads, curating of content, as well as the overall design of the architecture and its constant adaptation of algorithms through machine learning and new iterations, overall has created immense power over how information flows and what the information ecosystem looks like. So to aspire to bring more independent oversight to balance and check these powers is an aspiration shared by many who otherwise have nothing in common with President Trump's views. I also think that the executive order does not answer all questions, and it lacks legitimacy of a process that should include public consultations, deliberations, and much broader democratic debate and legitimacy. So I would say it has been mostly a political move meant to secure his own position, and we'll have to see whether that has been successful. In Europe, there is a variety of legislative initiatives that were already on the table that seek to rein in the unchecked power of tech companies. So I would say watch the anticipated Digital Services Act, but also initiatives around the updated data protection rules, e-commerce, artificial intelligence, and the EU data strategy. All in all, I think the fiddy between Trump and Twitter will not create a substantially new reality. It may empower Europeans a bit more to take actions that they would probably think they will do better at than those coming from either Silicon Valley or the White House. Thanks.
Marisha, thanks so much. And Eileen, can we now turn to you for a human rights perspective on this?
Yes, thank you, Kelly. I also want to just say it feels like the executive order happened an eternity ago, even though it was just Thursday. I want to start by underscoring the political nature of this whole episode, which my colleagues have already hit upon. So although presented as an effort to protect bedrock principles of free expression, I think on one level it was definitely a political stunt, almost to distract people from the fact that we had crossed the 100,000 deaths from COVID. But on a deeper political level, I think that the executive order is really about abuse of power. And so Daphne and Nate both touched on this. As I see it, the President of the United States is essentially threatening private sector platforms for exercising their own free expression because he doesn't like it. And this is what we might expect of authoritarian governments, and it feels quite ominous to have the President of the United States using the power of his office to go after American private sector platforms for political purposes. That's the most important takeaway here. Turning more explicitly to free expression principles under international law, which is quite similar, as Marisha said, to First Amendment analysis under the US Constitution. The starting place under international human rights law is Article 19 of the International Covenant on Civil Political Rights. It is quite a parallel to the First Amendment. Article 19 is not quite as protective of free expression as the First Amendment because it allows greater flexibility for legitimate government restrictions on free expressions, and it provides process principles, necessity, proportionality, legality, to assess legitimacy of those restrictions on the basis of things like national security and public health. But the basic approach is similar. In addition, I want to underscore that in the international human rights community, the core concept of platform immunity for user-generated speech, and that is the part that always has to be emphasized, that concept is seen as the linchpin of free expression, and it's almost sacrosanct. And the simple idea is raised by others is that the threat of liability for private sector platforms for the speech of their users, whether in the form of civil fines or criminal penalties, would basically shift the motivation of the private sector away from expanding free expression, and we would see an erosion of commitment to internet freedom. As Marisha said, this does not mean there is no basis for regulation of digital platforms. I think the much better way to go is start with privacy protections, focus on transparency with respect to advertising, transparency with respect to promotion, demotion of content through algorithms, and even transparency with respect to their own performance and in adhering to their own rules. Sadly, though, the global trend we see, very similar to this conversation about revocation of Section 230, is to approach this either through content regulation or revocation of immunity for liability for private sector platforms. Last point, this is a really strange, unbelievably strange political moment. And as everyone has said, there are very real concerns here about the impact of misinformation and disinformation, whether it's COVID related or election related. I do not think criminalization of misinformation is the right move. We see that happening globally, especially in the COVID context. And I don't think losing platform immunity for content generated by their users is the right way. But my fear is Donald Trump is basically sucking everybody into his vortex of chaos and confusion on this topic. And I think everybody has to watch out because we are going to all get dragged into this if we're not careful in terms of that political manipulation. So I'll stop there.
Thanks, Eileen. Great points there. And then Alex, can we turn to you?
Yeah, thank you. And it's good to be here with my colleagues on what is a bit of a tough morning for everybody. So just a couple of points. So first off, I think, you know, Daphne is one of the world's experts in this, and to just highlight some of the things she said, Daphne and I both worked at companies that have to make these speech decisions. And companies don't sit around and make these decisions based upon legal liability. The vast majority of content that is moderated by the platforms is legally protected in the place where it's moderated, right? So the majority of these decisions are made based upon their belief in what makes a platform that people want to use. And so, you know, CD230, while important, especially for small companies that don't have the ability to fight all of the lawsuits that they would get in a situation where they were doing content moderation, is not like the kind of thing that people sit around and talk about. That being said, working the refs can be effective. And there's a lot of people who work the refs, right? There's lots of people in government, both in their official positions in government, elected officials on their own, and the media who try to influence the rules of these companies. But generally, that's by criticism. In this case, President Trump has gone to a place that has happened before, but has generally only been seen in authoritarian countries, which is he is using a variety of laws that are irrelevant to the actual speech itself to threaten the platforms to change their policies. This happens actually pretty often, but generally with developing democracies that have trouble with speech rights and for non-democracies. An example of this, while I was at Facebook, we had to actually evacuate our office in Bangkok because we were in a fight with the authorities in Thailand who were threatening employees because Facebook was not taking down content that was critical of the local military junta. Now, in that case, Facebook actually stood up strong and resisted the requests. But what we've seen over the last couple of years is a tendency towards the platforms being more and more responsive to local law. And I think this is actually a really frightening direction. The other place we've seen Facebook do this is in Vietnam, where Facebook has, you know, while I was there, we had a bunch of fights with the Vietnamese government up to the point of where APT31, one of their hacking teams was actually trying to take over the accounts of people on the platform and going as far as creating fake IDs and the like. And we did a bunch of work, and now Facebook is taking down speech on behalf of the Vietnamese government. Now, to push back a bit on Maricha, the people who have opened the door for this more than anybody else is the Europeans. And Germany is the country that really set the expectation that global platforms will have their rules controlled by governments. Now, Germany is a real democracy. They have a bunch of different protections around rights. It's very hard once you open the door for local law having an impact on how these rules are interpreted globally. It's very hard to put that genie back in the bottle. And since the German SDG law, there's been a pretty smooth trend of the companies being more and more responsive to local law. And you have to be careful, even democracies, you have to be careful of who's in charge. We have Trump in the United States, but there are a variety of democracies, including European democracies, that are currently trending towards autocracy based upon somebody being democratically elected, but then not respecting democratic norms. Hungary, Poland being the best examples. So this working the refs, Trump has gone to another level here with the executive order. It's something the Trump administration started at least a year ago. They have been threatening a bunch of investigations of the platforms. A good example of this, of one that is pretty clearly politically motivated, was their department of Trump's Department of Housing and Urban Development, which has been not very good at enforcing civil rights rules around fair housing, announced an investigation of who are these worst offenders of the Fair Housing Act. And it turned out that the worst, in their mind, it was Google, Twitter, and Facebook, right? And so there's clearly been motivation for them to launch these investigations. You know, the equivalent here is imagine Bill de Blasio doesn't like the New York Times' coverage, which is probably true right now, and he just happens to shut down the Times building for health code violations. But, you know, it makes it clear that it's the editorial decision. That's what's going on here, that they are going to use it looks like the Trump administration is going to use all of the powers of the executive branch, which are incredibly strong, to then punish these companies if they don't bend his direction. In the case of Facebook, it looks like it's effective. Personally, I think Twitter's approach here is smart. There's a lot of options around speech you don't like other than taking it down. And that's something that gets lost in a lot of these conversations, that we get really focused on just straight up making speech disappear from these platforms. But there's many, many other levels. And I think in a situation like this, which is difficult, right? As a number of people have pointed out, it's very hard to deplatform the president of the United States when everything he says is often covered live on television and then will be repeated over and over again in the media. If the companies aren't going to go shut down every post that mentions the thing he said, then they have to be very careful about what they're going to do. In this case, I think Twitter did something very smart, creating the interstitial, lowering the ranking, making it harder to find the speech, and then basically exercising Twitter's First Amendment right to say, we do not agree with this speech, even though we're carrying it, I think was a really smart move. And Facebook has the capability to do that, and they've decided not to. I think one of the issues that I tweeted about last week is there's a structure inside of Facebook is that the people who make platform policy decisions are in the same organization and go to the same VP as the people who have to keep governments happy. And so making like the decisions of what you think is right or wrong to for the same people to also be motivated by their government relations job, I think is actually a significant conflict of interest. From the TikToks that have come out of how Twitter made this decision, it sounds like those groups are completely different within Twitter. I think that's appropriate. Now, in the end, Mark Zuckerberg made this decision. This is his responsibility. And I think he's lost his way a bit in that he is no longer, you know, especially if he is talking to the White House, if he is having phone calls with the person with whom he is making these moderation decisions, it's impossible for him to claim that they're just fairly applying the rules. And I think he lost an opportunity here, and I hope he follows and takes the opportunity he has now to treat this speech differently. Because what's going to happen now? I think we're going to see two things out of the White House. First, Trump is going to push the edge both on Twitter and Facebook. He's going to try to get Twitter to take his content down. He's going to try to get Facebook to follow Twitter in labeling it because he relishes this fight, right? We're talking about this fight and not about 104,000 Americans dead from COVID-19. We're talking about the speech issues and not the legitimate grievances that underlie these protests across the country. So he wants the fight. His supporters are definitely open to a fight with, you know, West Coast liberals who control these platforms, as he would say. And so he's going to push the edge by making the content more and more extreme until he hits some kind of red line. And I expect that red line will be around calls for violence, perhaps even singling out individuals. Both Twitter and Facebook have pretty strong rules around if you threaten violence to an individual person, that should get you taken down. And so that's the place where I think you'll push the line. And then I think the second thing that we're getting set up for is, and I'll go back to Daphne and Nate for the legality here, but you know, the president has also threatened to name Antifa a terrorist organization, which one, Antifa is like not a thing like ISIS or Al-Qaeda or some, you know, organization actually exists. It's just a label people apply to themselves. It's also domestic, which my understanding is the law does not allow domestic groups. But where this goes in the speech-wise is one of the only ways that the U.S. government has been able to censor other people on these platforms has been by designating them as terrorist organizations. And this has actually been somewhat of a quiet fight that has become very important now, which is starting in the ISIS days, the use of designating these groups was used to deplatform ISIS from Facebook, from Twitter, from YouTube. And so now if he is going to say people that support protests against me are part of a terrorist organization, he is going to try to make the argument that the same deplatforming that happened to ISIS, that happened to the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps in Iran, should happen to Antifa. And I expect that that's the escalation we will see this week, is him not just saying that he should be protected, but also trying to use the power of the executive branch to punish these companies if they allow speech to exist, which will be a huge test of the ability of the companies to resist the incredible power of the U.S. executive branch. So, thank you.
Thank you all. This was really a great overview and set of reactions to what has happened. And I'm glad we have some time left for Q&A. We have quite a few really interesting questions here. I'm going to start Daphne, with you and really going to just some very specific clarifications and questions about what has happened and what is possible. I then want to turn to, and so I'll just seed with everyone, with all of our other panelists, two questions that sort of emerge from the dozen or more that we've received. One is this question about the politics of all of this. Nate, to you, a question around the politics of support for 230. And then also Larry Diamond and Marcos, thank you for your questions around you know, whether there is symmetry in the bias that we're seeing on the platforms, whether the charges of political bias are true. So just want to tee up for all of you guys that will, after turning to Daphne, we want to talk about that. And then I'd like to talk about solutions here. If it's not, you know, everyone agrees that there is a problem. If the solution is not, you know, removing immunity, what are other, and you know, Eileen, you spoke to ideas around transparency, but would love to see what you guys think about that. So giving you time to think about that. And then first, Daphne, I'm going to barrage you with some very specific questions. Okay. Of the over, quote unquote, 16,000 complaints that we've seen, will we have access, you know, collected by the White House in this tech bias reporting tool? Are these complaints available for public view? Is there metadata about them? What do we know about that?
Sure, can you hear me?
Yes, perfectly.
Excellent. I don't know. That's a really good question. The White House put up this tech bias reporting tool before, encouraging people to complain if they believe they've been the victim of bias against anyone, but presumably it's mostly people who think anti-conservative bias is at stake. That tool is being reinstated, and then the reports that are filed in it will be channeled to this, among other places, this discussion convened with the state attorneys general. And then what you might see from that is the state attorneys general pointing to a particular instance and trying to get discovery against platforms and try to surface some kind of additional documents they can use. But in terms of whether there will be public access, I don't know. It's an interesting question. It would be very valuable to have something like that, but also to have something that is less political in the first instance, so that, you know, you could hope to have more meaningful aggregate data. And of course, the real way to get the meaningful aggregate data about what the problems are would be, as Eileen said, with better platform transparency about what the complaints are that they're receiving, what is being taken down, you know, the possibility for third-party inquiry, not just about the question of political bias in the US, but about questions of who is being blocked as a terrorist organization around the world. You know, are these blocks being enforced in a way that has potentially language-based bias or religious bias? So there are very big questions that can only be solved with better information.
Thank you, Daphne. That's really helpful. And we're not done yet. I still have three more for you, so hang in there. When do you think we will actually start to see people suing or attempting to enforce the executive order? What is the process going to look like procedurally to potentially get it overturned? What will happen next?
So part of the question for lawyers is, when has something happened that is bad enough that you have standing to go into court and challenge it? So a lot of the things in the executive order won't happen for a minimum of 30 days, because it's things like 30 days from now, NTIA, it's part of the Commerce Department, will deliver this request to the FCC, and then maybe the FCC does something. So those parts are hard to challenge now. But there are parts like the beginning of the process of compiling this blacklist of platforms whose speech policies are not approved or are considered to engage in viewpoint discrimination. Those parts are presumably could be underway today. And so maybe that gives a hook for either platforms or their trade associations or public interest organizations that are interested in civil liberties to try to go into court over this.
Okay, thank you. Next up, any potential impact on other companies outside of social media? I'm thinking Amazon reviews, you know, could you put in the comment this question of, could you push companies to sell American-made products? Like, how might this affect other internet companies?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And the definition of the kinds of platforms that are covered by this is really broad. So we should be thinking about Amazon. We should be thinking about, you know, Bing and Google web search. We should be thinking about your cousin's knitting blog or the New York Times that permits comments. All of those things are in scope. The other thing that I would say is worth paying attention to is just how similar this is to pressure that the president has put on traditional media. So sort of bullying and threats toward the Washington Post or CNN or the New York Times, ordering federal agencies to stop subscribing to those publications. And you know, to me, these are very much of a piece. It's use of state power to try to shape what editorial policies are adopted by independent companies. And unfortunately, we see another similarity, which is in the real threats of violence to individuals who work for those companies. We've seen really frightening violence against individual reporters over the past couple of days. And I know that the companies whose employees have been called out by name in the discussion of the executive order are similarly very worried about being in the crosshairs in this way.
Thank you, Daphne. Yeah, and then we have a few questions. This is an easy one hopefully, best sources for understanding CDA 230. If you could enter those into the Q&A, and also a number of requests for your annotated version, which I know, Michelle, you copied into the chat amongst all of us, but we actually would love to just add that to the Q&A so that everyone has access to what Daphne has been sharing. And then before moving to the politics of this and solutions, sort of in the realm of solutions, we've had a number of questions around CDA 230. Frank Fukuyama appreciated your question of, if abolished, what is the thought exercise around how the platforms would respond? My sense is that they would get much more aggressive in their moderation, and the incentives would be there. And then also, and this is for everyone, both of these are, you know, what changes, CDA 230 has been around for, you know, 20 years. What changes do we think we should see, if any, or is it fine as is? I don't know who'd like to start on that. Nate?
Well, so I'll just say, this question of what happens if 230 is abolished, that we don't really know. I mean, we actually have a world that existed before 230, which is a very different internet than what we have right now. It is possible that then, yes, the platforms would become very aggressive in trying to moderate content for which they would see themselves as being liable. Daphne has written in many places, you know, we often think about this as just being about the big platforms like Google, YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook. These are one, you know, these are companies that do have the capacity to have massive content moderation schemes, but what about all of the many small companies that receive the protection of 230 and that wouldn't be able to shield themselves from the onslaught of lawsuits if they were going to be responsible for all of the material on their platform? I should add that Daphne actually has a chapter in a forthcoming edited volume of mine on the status of 230, and also we have some chapters in there on changes to 230. That's a co-authored volume with Josh Tucker on social media and democracy coming out in the fall. And some of the chat questions were asking about, well, what changes could be made? There are lots of different ways that one could modify 230 without getting rid of the entire thing, to go after clearly illegal speech, to go after bots, to go after different particular problems that one might you know, see with internet speech, without then forcing the platforms to take responsibility for all the speech that occurs on them. Let me respond to, I believe it was Marcos's question in the chat about the politics of 230, and just thinking about, like, what does this do to the kind of coalition that had been supporting a free internet? And I think that's a difficult question to answer. I mean, because there are voices on the left and the right who have been wanting to upend 230, right? So on the right, it's because of political bias. On the left, it's because of the awesome power of the platforms and a feeling that they need to do more in taking down speech, right? Even if it's, as Alex said, legal and constitutionally protected speech. But I will be interested in seeing following this executive order and the politics, political response to it, is whether we now get a more polarized response to the viability of 230, where Democrats are now going to be more likely to support it, whereas Republicans will be more likely to be against it. I think, you know, right now the Silicon Valley companies are not exactly in high regard across the board, but you know, in as was true in 2016, it really just depends on what they're seeing in terms of controlling content for the election. And so I think a lot hinges on how, you know, people perceive they behave for the campaign.
Yeah. Thank you, Nate. Any other thoughts on amendments, Eileen, to 230? Yeah.
So just joining the three questions about the politics of support for 230 or revocation of 230, Larry's empirical question about whether there, you know, is there symmetry in the takedowns or the demotion? And then Frank's question about potentially what would it look like to abolish 230. I'll start with the basics. I think it's a gigantic mistake for anybody, right, left, or anywhere, to be talking about abolishing 230 right now. It is so politically fraught. And I would really warn people on the left who are clamoring for more disinformation to be taken down and thinking that is the solution. I fear everybody's being used politically manipulated. I also will remind everybody who thinks that there's bias toward the right, free expression does not require that private sector platforms provide an outlet for disinformation about elections or about COVID or conspiracy theories about anything. And putting a label on a tweet is not censorship. So the tremendous irony here is that Donald Trump's has had his voice amplified massively by Twitter, you know, 80 million plus followers. He came into office with something like 2 to 3 million. And so it is so, there's so many ironies here that he is the one complaining about free expression. On the empirical question, I'm just going to raise something that's even a harder question. I don't know who has the facts of whether there is disproportionate censorship, but I would suggest that even if the facts show disproportionate outcomes, that it might be, in fact, because more people on the right are violating community guidelines in terms of inciting violence, inciting hatred, et cetera. And, you know, so I think we have to look at that part of the factual situation as well. And I can hold on the solutions piece until the end if you want us to.
Great, thanks. Yes, any other responses on potential modifications to CDA 230 before we turn to, or on the politics of this? I know we did a talk, actually, Nate, not that, well, I guess it was over a year ago with Yohai Bankler on his book, Network Propaganda, where he really makes an assertion that there is asymmetric bias here. So any thoughts from anyone else on CDA 230, the politics of this, or potential biases, both in content that is asymmetry in content that is put up and asymmetry in what's taken down?
I'll speak briefly to the idea that CDA either does require or should be amended to require neutrality by platforms. This is a pretty common theme voiced by Ted Cruz, among others, and I think it sounds intuitively reasonable to people, but in practice, what it would mean is the only way a platform could have immunity for user speech and therefore be able to be a place we can all go speak immediately without being reviewed by lawyers, the only way to do that would be to allow all the speech, to allow all the bullying, all the racism, to allow all of the sort of cesspool of constitutionally protected but harmful, obnoxious, offensive, et cetera, speech to be on the platform. And so if it were true that you only got CDA 230 immunity, this essential protection, by being neutral, then all platforms would have to become essentially like pre-internet entities. They would have to either act like a telecoms, you know, phone company transmitting everything equally with no editorial policies and no content moderation, or they would have to become like broadcasters and newspapers with lawyers vetting every single word before it could go out. And nobody actually wants to go back to those things. Like we have to find a middle ground where platforms do have a different set of rules that allow them to be these, you know, incredible forums for free public discussion for ordinary citizens, and aren't forced into those two old media categories by a neutrality requirement.
Thanks, Daphne. And Alex, it looked like you might have something here.
Yeah, just real quickly. I mean, to reinforce what Daphne says, if there was no content moderation, these platforms would be unusable, completely unusable, right? So I recommend people who are interested in this space, Facebook has started publishing these content moderation transparency reports. And what you'll see is that there is 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000 times more moderation of things like spam, nudity, other kind of things that are not as politically controversial as there is of the controversial, more controversial areas like hate speech and threats and political speech. And so if you move to we have some examples of non-moderated spaces and they become complete and total cesspits and are completely unusable very, very quickly. And so there is a need for some kind of moderation. I think in this case, we're talking about, again, constitutionally protected speech. So to be frank, the Democratic Party has been completely inconsistent on this, and I think it's a little bit lost. Everybody glommed onto 230 because it's, this is actually, I think, one of the reasons our center needs to exist, is that those of us in the academic world have not been giving options to policymakers of how they respond. And so everybody's like, oh, well, we'll fix 230 and that will fix it. And so you have people saying, oh, we get rid of 230 and then the companies will do more moderation. And then other people saying, we'll get rid of 230 and they'll do less. They can't both be right. And in fact, they're probably both wrong to a certain extent. So I do think that there's other options here, but Democrats as a whole going into this election period need to come up with a consistent view. Because right now it looks like Joe Biden has endorsed Donald Trump's view, which is like not, I think, a winning argument for the party right now.
This has been such a fascinating conversation. I'm hoping you guys might all be able to stay on a couple minutes after, but I'm going to lay out the questions now and see if we can get through most of them in the next 5 minutes. I want to turn to solutions. We have seen in the behavioral science literature really mixed data on the impact of fact checks. We've seen comments, if it's not a lack of immunity, you know, what is the right solution here? It sounds like Jack Dorsey had opened up, you know, crowdsource fact checking as a potential long-term goal. And I think Nate, you know, we've seen some of the data on that that you could speak to. So I would love to hear just 30 seconds from each of you of like, what do you think are a couple of solutions here? And then just to preview what I will be asking next, Alex, would love to hear your thoughts on what Zuckerberg's strategy is here, how Zuck should be responding to interference from the administration. Like, what is your perspective there? And then time permitting, just given the gravity of, you know, everything that's going on right now, not to put you on the spot, Alex, sorry. And then just the gravity of everything that's going on right now with the riots, any thoughts about the role of social media here? And Lucy Bernholtz, you had a really good question around, you know, what we're now seeing as some connections between online speech and physical protests and assembly, and how do we think about regulations in this space, potentially beyond just communication, since we're now getting into, you know, other areas. So a lot to cover. I'm hoping maybe some of you guys can stay on for 5 minutes after to get through all of this, but want to start with solutions.
Let me start with fact checking, which you raised at the beginning. Now, I want to be clear that one could be against what Twitter did in these instances, against the executive order, and against blanket 230 immunity all at the same time, right? And so it is unclear to me whether, you know, Twitter's actions to put the fact checks next to Trump's name has done anything except amplified the content that were in those tweets and then actually made them more, you know, sort of to gain greater reach. And so something like that, just the flagging of the president's tweet, I think in and of itself does very little. And, you know, most of what these kinds of fact checks do is that they will draw attention to the underlying content that is being fact checked. Now, there are good ways and bad ways to do fact checking. And a lot of it has to do with, well, again, whether you use, for what reason you're using the fact checks. Now, a lot of what the platform policies on disinformation have been doing over the last few years is to use fact checks to then, as a cause for demoting the content. So you both obscure the content, as by the way, Facebook itself has done on many occasions, and then you dilute it with alternative sources, and then you demote it by putting it at the end of users' feeds. But you know, just putting a flag next to the president's tweet, I don't think did anything to then lead people not to believe the content about what he was saying about mail balloting.
Thank you, Nate. Yes, and you've seen all these allegations of backfire effects from fact-checking and so forth. Can I see a quick show of hands from panelists who can stay for 5 minutes after? Because otherwise I want to make sure I hear last words. Oh, good. Okay, great. So other thoughts on solutions? And while we're going there, a great question from Rebecca McKinnon. Rebecca, nice to see you here, and I really enjoyed the webinar you guys did last week at Ranking Digital Rights. Rebecca added to this question of solutions, would a moratorium on targeted advertising between now and the elections help? So, and it looks like Alex has thoughts on that. But Marita, did you want to go next on the solution side?
Yeah, just briefly, because I have to go to another webinar, but I think we have to also push ourselves to be very clear on solutions for what, because we're now talking about fact-checking, we're talking about labeling, we're talking about foreign interference, and I don't think that that's what Section 230 is about. I think we're actually already touching on the various ways in which these big commercially run tech platforms are powerful. And I do think that that is a challenge as such. And there may be a variety of tools, anything from antitrust, which in combination with transparency would allow people to make better informed choices. You know, if people would not like the kind of community that Twitter is creating with higher standards in terms of what it expects from members' behavior, then they should be able to move to other platforms. But if you don't know what kind of selections you are subject to, then it becomes a harder decision to make. And if there's not enough competition, then there may not be many alternatives available, et cetera, et cetera. So I see solutions in a combination of steps in the direction of transparency, more accountability, and making sure that laws that we cherish, concepts of the rule of law, apply in the digital world. And so that should protect free speech in a firm way. I would like to see the commercial platforms actually anchoring their regulation of speech in known principles, like Eileen said, universal human rights of speech protection, to make sure that we don't have a completely commercialized vague set of criteria that users have no sense of. So those are just a couple of thoughts. I know there's more, but I have to say goodbye at this point.
Right. Thank you, Maricha. And I promise others, we will not stay more than 5 more minutes, but quick additional thoughts on solutions, or would love to turn, Alex, to your thoughts on what Zuckerberg's strategy might be here. Oh, Eileen.
I'll do quick solutions because of Rebecca's question about transparency with respect to targeted advertising. I want to highlight a paper that's been done by something called the Transatlantic High-Level Working Group on Content Moderation and Freedom of Expression, recently published paper, or it's actually the final is just coming out. Marija and I are both working with that group, and it has a very rich proposal on various forms of transparency as the better first step here. And helping users understand why their content was taken down, what is the complaint procedure, what are the remedies, helping governments understand how algorithmic promotion and demotion is actually working and affecting the outcome of what different people see. And then for independent researchers, providing an ability to audit the outcomes of that algorithmic promotion and demotion and see whether platforms are actually living up to their own principles. And I think that's a much better place to go, as well as the obvious one is, you know, transparency about advertising on platforms. And the rules can be different around advertising than user-generated content. So I think that's a key point.
Thank you. And Eileen, if you can post that, if the paper is available, in the chat, that would be fantastic. Alex.
So on the advertising, I mean, we called in our big paper on election security, we called for advertising controls. My personal representative, Anna Eshoo, has just proposed, a pretty reasonable approach to controlling political advertising. That being said, I think that is completely irrelevant to this issue. This is organic speech by the President of the United States. And a lot of people pivot to the advertising side because it gives them kind of this easy moralistic position of this is all about the money and stuff. No, there's a hard trade-off here. How much power do unelected trillion-dollar corporations have to control the speech of democratically elected leaders? That's super hard, right? And so let's not avoid the hard problem by pivoting to it's the algorithm, it's the, no, that needs to be fixed, but that is irrelevant to this specific issue. As for what Zuckerberg's doing, I don't know, right? Because I think he's played, you know, he's playing defense here and trying to find some kind of middle position where he personally disagrees. But I think the two things that really ruined his neutrality stance is going on Fox News and, you know, to defend his position instead of in a much more neutral platform, like just with a Facebook Live, and then talking to the president directly. And I think, he has inserted himself into a place that he has become a political player here. I think his best out is the content review board. Like, I think these kind of multi-stakeholder models where we can see transparently smart people argue over the trade-offs and then make the decisions in a transparent manner after taking a bunch of input, that's a good place for the platforms to go instead of just straight up regulation by governments, which can be abused, as we can see here. And so Facebook's done all this work, but it seems to be taking more time to set up this Facebook Supreme Court than it took to create the real Supreme Court of the United States. I think like there's, if I was him, my suggestion would be like, you get that thing working this week and you should start to have a transparent, open debate about how to handle control of speech of elected officials from democracies. And that should be the first thing, and to vastly expand the remit of the oversight board to have these discussions, because right now the currently documented remit does not include it. And I think that's the best way out here. You know, going on Fox News, talking to the president, and then deciding not to take a decision that I think is a pretty reasonable one that Twitter did, I think is the wrong direction for a number of reasons.
Can I just say 10 seconds on this, which is that Facebook and Twitter's policies on this are actually not that different from each other. And it's like one of these things to then, for Facebook to throw Twitter under the bus, partly because Facebook's been sort of living there for the last few years, you know, it's a little ironic. I mean, because it's not as, when they pronounce, or Zuckerberg pronounced, oh, we don't want to be the arbiters of truth. They do these kinds of things all the time where they will put warning labels on top of organic content, that they will demote it, that they'll do fact checking. So they're in that business because you can't get out of it. And so the fact that they drew the line at the president might be significant, right? But they are in that business of being the arbiters of truth when it suits them.
All right. I know we are basically at time. I would love to just spend maybe 2 minutes, because it's so top of mind for all of us, on the riots and the role of social media there and these connections between online speech and physical protests. If you guys have any thoughts on that, recognizing it's sort of a sobering note to end on, but I think really top of mind for everybody. Anyone?
Well, I'll just say that, as we said at the beginning, right, that there is, right, these are two different worlds that we're talking about, and we should not make the riot story a technology story that denigrates the authenticity of the grievances that are leading to them. However, as Alex and others were saying, there is, as we look forward to what is going to be happening in the next few months, the regulation of the speech marketplace is going to become even more important because we're talking about protests, after all. We're talking about people taking these issues to authority out in the streets. And so whether the authorities are then, whether it's through the anti-Antifa measures that the president has announced on Twitter or other kinds of restrictions on activity and using social media as a lever, right, that is going to be quite important. Let's also just say the obvious, right, which is that social media does enable coverage of these protests from people on the ground, right, to go through the legacy intermediaries, which might have restricted the permissible range of content in previous eras.
All right.
Our team has spent the entire weekend kind of studying what's going on, both in open social media and some of the closed groups. There's a lot of organizing going on online, both for the protesters and the, you know, some of the counter protesters. It looks like there are some people that have talked about creating violent situations to discredit the protesters or to accelerate civil war. I want to be clear, the problems people have with policing this country is completely legitimate. This is not some kind of, there is no evidence that these protests are caused by Russian bots or some kind of manipulation online. of course, we are going to see America's adversaries take advantage of our legitimate problems to try to attack American democracy. A lot of that's coming from overt sources, such as Chinese state media, Russian state media, and the like. But there is no evidence that a significant portion of this has been driven by anything but Americans who are actually legitimately upset about what's going on in this country. We're starting to see this argument get built. So Senator Marco Rubio, who now, thanks to some insider trading issues, is now the acting head of the Senate Intelligence Committee, tweeted about these protests being driven by outside agitators. And we got to be super careful here, because I guarantee if you look hard enough, you will be able to find some bots being run by probably Russia and Iran would be the best, the most likely, that are tweeting about this. That does not mean, you know, that this is driven by them. And so we, I think, in the academic space and the people who study disinformation have to be really, really careful and crisp about separating there is online activity that should be stopped by the platforms or should be known about, and separate that from the causality of the protests or of violence. And I think that, you know, along with the Antifa stuff, an argument is starting to be made for censorship of people who are calling for protest that I think is not backed up by any evidence. And I think if politicians like Senator Rubio are going to say those things, they need to also provide real evidence, because that those are significant claims that should require significant backup.
Thank you, Alex. Yeah, really helpful. Other thoughts from others before we close? All right. Yeah, a really sobering time. But I'm feeling extremely appreciative right now of the amazing job that I have, that I get to have breaking news things happen and then have some of the best minds in the space to where I used to sit down and ask you all questions. So thank you so much for making the time, and to the audience here. Just a last comment as we close, that we will have another webinar this week. It's part of our bi-weekly series. It's every other Wednesday at 10 a.m. PST. This one will be a slightly different focus for us, where we have focused so much on sort of democracy, security, geopolitics. But we've invited colleagues from the Knight Network who are doing work more around markets and economics to talk about the move to online e-commerce under COVID and some of the risks associated with dynamic pricing, kind of predatory pricing technologies. And so this will be a different focus than we typically have, but I think will be a really interesting conversation. So for those who want to join, would love to see you on Wednesday. And thank you so much, Nate, Daphne, Eileen, Alex, and Maricha, who is now gone, for taking the time today. This has been really helpful. All right. Thanks, all. Stay well.